Hey there, fellow marketers, Professor Walters here, and today we're going to focus on the task environment or immediate environment. And this is to deal with the kind of pest analysis, you know, when we talk about macroeconomic factors that kind of influence business that we kind of just react to, you know, like political stuff, economic, social, cultural, technological changes, those things. Those are outside our sphere. We can only kind of adjust them afterwards. But our immediate environment, our task environment, these are things that we as a company can do something about. We can decide who we hire. We can decide who we work with. We can do our best to fight off our competition. And so these are things we can actually deal with, and they also directly affect us. What our competition does directly affects what we can do. And so when we look at this immediate environment, some things that we can directly affect is what we can actually control. One thing you look at is our capabilities. What are our business? What can our business do? We can figure out what we can do, and we can work on that. That's why one of the things you look at in the immediate environment is the labor supply. Okay, the employees we hire, the people that work with us, these kind of things. We're looking at them. We're deciding, hey, if we want to be a better, you know, rebounding basketball team, we're gonna draft people that are better rebounders, right? So we're gonna look at that. What we have to think about though is our available pool of workers will affect our strategy, because just because we want to draft people or add people to our team that can rebound better, well, if there's nobody available that can rebound better, well, we might need to change what we're doing, right? Oh, we can only get 3-point shooters, then we need to change our strategies. We're not gonna be a defense rebounding team, we're gonna be a 3-point shooting team, right? So we're gonna look at that. And it's like this: if you wanna build bridges, you need to hire builders and engineers, right? And so you think about that. And the thing is, if there's something you really want that you really need, you're gonna have to go out and pay for it. It's not like people walk in, because if they have a skill that you really need, you can't just say, I'm gonna pay you this low price. You're gonna have to pay them better, and that's gonna influence you. That's why the best workers get hired away, because they look, that person's a transformative force in this business. We want them working for us, and so the pay goes higher. So that's gonna influence you. That's why you'll see, you know, the best players in the league get paid a lot of money, and the average players get paid a lot less, because having LeBron, having Steph Curry makes a lot bigger difference than having, you know, Judd Bushler or somebody like that, right? And so you have to think about that. And the thing is, when you're looking at your labor supply, that is really things that, like, the capabilities they have, we can kind of control that. And if we don't have these capabilities in our labor supply, we can train them up and help them learn, right? And so that can help us out. So we can control it that way. Now, another thing you have to look at in our immediate environment is our customers, right? I mean, your customers, you can deal with them. You can talk to them. You can give them a better deal. You can send a better sales representative there. I mean, how many of you thought you'd go to the university you're at from the day you were born? You didn't. You went on a visit, you met the people there, you talked to the advisors, and they sold it to you, right? And they said, that's why I want to go to this university. Well, when you're dealing with your customers, your sales approach is something you can deal with, because we really have to focus on our customers, because our customers really determine our success. If we have customers, yay, we make money and survive. If we don't have customers, we got some problems. And so that's why it's important you do your research, you understand what their wants and demands are. You know that wants and demands comes up a lot in marketing, right? You know those things and you try to deliver on those things, but you have to realize the type of products you're making will determine the demand. You know, like if you're making ketchup, like you don't eat ketchup as the main meal, right? You are, if they buy hot dogs, you're going along with it. If you're making hamburgers, you go along with it, right? So the type of product you make will influence your demand. And so we have to think about that, because there's a difference between that final demand and the derived demand. Like the final demand is, I want a hot dog. But our demand is derived from hot dog sales. It's like tires. The number of tires sold depends on how many cars people are buying. You don't buy 8 tires for your car, you buy 4 tires and maybe a spare, so 5 for your car, right? So you think about that. Also, if you look at your customers, you might like look at it in terms of, are they buying, you know, producer goods versus consumer goods? I mean, think about it. You buy a toaster for yourself, hey, it just has to toast 2 pieces of toast. But if you're, you know, buying a toaster for, you know, Waffle House, man, you got to go through a lot of toast when you're there. So that's going to influence what your customers are buying, how they're going to buy. And so you have to adjust to that. Also, you might look at it in terms of the type of product they're buying, in terms of durable good versus perishable goods. You know, if you're buying something that's going to last for 20 years, it's going to be different how you're going to sell to them versus something they eat right away and it's gone. And so we really have to think about these things, because demand from your customers can vary greatly depending on you know, what they want and what they need and what you're selling. So we really have to put that in there. But that's things you can really control. Another thing you can control are your suppliers. You can choose who you work with, okay? Like, look, if I want my burger joint to seem like it's better, I'm gonna go find a better farmer that has better beef, right? Or better cheese, and I'm gonna use that. And that's why you can control your suppliers. Because if you think about it, you as a student, don't you choose who supplies your co-work in projects? Just be like, no, I don't wanna work with them because they never do any work in the projects. I mean, we all have friends that do that. And if you don't have a friend that doesn't do the work of the project, you're probably that friend that doesn't do it. And the thing is, with your suppliers, you might be looking at your long-term costs with them versus your short-term costs, how they can deliver to you, when they can deliver to you. Because if you're doing just-in-time production, it's going to be very different. They have a big warehouse holding everything. And so that's going to influence you. And that's something you can actually decide. Hey, is it worth the opportunity cost for me to work with them versus somebody else? Yes or no? You have to take that into account. And then, of course, you have your competition. And your competition, I mean, your competition can kill you. Your competition also can inspire you to do better. I mean, how iPhone killed all that competition, like Nokia and stuff, it also inspired Samsung to come out with a better phone. And so we have the Galaxy out there, right? And for all those Amazon competition that you know, people say it's driving them out of business. But you know what? They learned, and like other businesses learned, wait, we can also do online e-commerce and we can survive. So your competition can drive you. You have to compete with them. You got to figure out, how do I beat Amazon at their own game? What can I do, right? And so we take that into consideration. And if you look at your competition, you're looking at, hey, you know, what's our history? Is this one of those, we fight to the last dollar kind of competition stuff, so I know I gotta fight with everything? We're having price wars all the time? Or is it one of these things that, hey, I can have different pricing strategies? I could be the high end and they could be the medium end, or they could be the low and I could be the high, whatever. You think about these and you can adjust, because look, McDonald's comes out with a dollar menu, you better believe everybody else is going to come out, their competition is going to come out is with some other value meals as well, because they know, look, our competition's done that, we have to adjust. You don't just sit back and let your competition beat you up, you have to do something, okay? And so that's why it's really important when you look at the task environment, the immediate environment, there's so many things going on that really directly affect your business. You need to pay attention to it and you need to be doing something about it. You need to be having strategies to keep up with the best labor practices and how to keep up with your competition and beat them and how to deal with your suppliers and find the right ones out there and training up your people and figuring out your customers and think about their demand. Is it elastic demand? Like if we change the price a little, it'll go up or down? Or is it inelastic? No matter what we charge, they're gonna buy it? I mean, we have to think about that and know that so we can fight on and do a better job. Because some things, those macro factors we talked about, you know, in the other videos, the political and economic and social, those things, hey, we're just riding the wave with them. We're just trying to surf it the best we can. This one, we can build that dam to stop our competition. We can choose the people who work with us to help fight through these things. We can do that in our immediate environment. Okay, now it's called immediate environment or task environment, depending which way you look at the model. So I just want to let you know that. Anyway, I wish you all the best and I'll say bye.